Hello again. The Practical Animal Channel is dedicated to the public understanding of conservation by interviewing vets, ecologists, and reserve managers to provide the information students need. Besides ideas for animal projects, you'll find out what to wear for an interview and good questions to ask. Today's guest is an expert on caracals. Dr. Laurel Series is a conservation scientist with the non-governmental organization Panthera's Small Cats program. She set up the Urban Caracal Project in South Africa for her PhD. If small wildcat conservation interests you, and setting up your own conservation project is your goal, then listen to the end for how Laurel did it. Please consider subscribing. Cats are predators. Conservation is not for the squeamish, and neither is this video. Your best caracal fact, please.
How high they can jump. So they can jump more than 3 meters, and they do that when they're hunting birds. So that's something that really impresses me. And then just something that we've learned through our research is how adaptable they are. So I think that's less exciting and sexy for the public, but they're just an extremely adaptable species that can survive in a lot of different kinds of environments. And to me, that's really thrilling and interesting.
Laurel, please, can you complete this sentence? Caracals are?
Caracals are stunningly beautiful. You develop a really soft spot in your heart for the animals and just become captivated even by their appearance. So that's what sticks with me when I think about caracals.
What jobs are there with caracals?
I founded the Urban Caracal Project in 2014. It was actually part of my academic training. So I got my PhD in 2014 in Los Angeles studying bobcats. And for my next step, I wanted to work abroad. And I wanted to work in Cape Town. In Cape Town, there's caracals. So that's how caracals came about. I was more about the location than the species. And then I found the funding for the position. So I essentially created the job. It's mostly people in academic situations that work with them and do research on them.
Why are caracals important?
So caracals are a medium-sized cat. The smaller wild cats can teach us a lot about ecosystems, so they can be ecological indicators of the health of an ecosystem. So, for example, because they're predators, if people are using pesticides in the environment to target animals like rodents, so rat poisons, those will bioaccumulate and you can detect them in caracals. So, and if there's diseases in the system, or, you know, there's not a healthy balance of prey in the system, this is something that by studying caracals, you can learn a lot about the ecosystem. But in terms of value to humans, they're also just, I mean, these beautiful charismatic animals that I think just, you know, they add natural beauty to ecosystems, and we're learning more and more about how nature is important to the health of humans and being around that and experiencing it. And I think that caracals are part of that system as well.
What does your job involve?
Conducting fieldwork. And that fieldwork entailed going out to where the caracals were living in the mountains around Cape Town and capturing them, putting GPS collars on them, tracking them, so monitoring them while they had the collars on. And then using the collar data, we could backtrack their data on their movements on the ground to those locations and learned about what they were eating and where they were resting on the landscape. So in the beginning, the first few years, it was just a lot of being outdoors in the mountains with the caracals, in a sense. We rarely saw them, despite, you know, being able to track them with collars. They're extremely elusive. Once the field work was over, then my job has largely been just desk work of analyzing the data that we collected and writing manuscripts. And in fact, I mean, for the duration of the project, the fieldwork is actually a relatively short and small component compared to the number of years that we've spent analyzing data, conducting additional laboratory analyses.
What skills does a person need to work with caracals?
So I have a PhD in biology. The skills I brought to the project were experience working in the field, just outdoors, experience trapping small wild cats or medium-sized cats, which in itself is an own, you know, is a skill set that can take years to develop. And having some technological savvy about how to operate the collars that we put on the animals, being able to manage data in an organized fashion, conduct statistical analyses with the data, and then having the skill set to write scientific publications, which are really essential if you want to promote the conservation of a species and the management of a species, is to put your findings in scientific journals that have been peer reviewed, and then, you know, local conservation agencies will pay more attention to your work. So that's my skill set. I also, when I was in graduate school, I was in a conservation genetics lab. So I have experience analyzing genetic data now, as well as spatial ecology data. But not everyone needs to have a PhD to work with caracals. I had a PhD student who was working on the caracals, and all she had was a bachelor's degree when she started. And so I think it takes some higher education, you know, at least going to university, and then just an interest and a passion for the species. And then you have to figure out some way to support yourself financially while you're doing what you want to do with the caracals. So, yeah, I would say that those are sort of the essential must-haves to be able to, and this is to study caracals.
Mm-hmm. Laurel, how would you describe caracal conservation today?
So their geographic range is quite widespread. It's one of the most widespread for any wildcat. They're found throughout much of Africa, in Asia. But in those Asian countries, their densities are thought to be much lower and their status to be more threatened. But generally, especially in South Africa, there's so many caracals. There's not a lot known about caracals outside of South Africa. So there's a lot of fear about the impact that the economic impact that caracals can have on farmers. So unfortunately, the conservation of caracals, there's nothing really happening to promote that.
Laurel, how do you see caracal management and conservation proceeding for the rest of the 21st century?
They're considered a species of least concern. So they're so abundant in some areas and they're so geographically widespread. So long as they're considered an abundant species that's actually a pest species in Southern Africa, then their management and conservation, I unfortunately just don't see a path forward for how to protect them. And luckily, they just seem like such a resilient species that they're here, as I said, despite all the persecution and despite, you know, a changing landscape. And as well, We are learning about pesticide exposure, and so we can have public campaigns to try to reduce the use of rat poison, for example, and just educate people generally. But otherwise, I would say it looks pretty dim for conservation and management moving forward. I think they're just a species that's on their own for the foreseeable future.
How did your own career develop?
So I have always had an interest in studying wild cats, and that's sort of something rarely do people with my level of education want to admit that we're really interested in the field and developing our skill sets because we just really like cats. You know, I really like cats. But since I was from a very young age, I was interested in wild cats. Of course, as a young child, I was more interested in larger cats, you know, like maybe leopards or lions or tigers, and didn't really think about the smaller cousins. From age 10 years old, I knew I needed a PhD, you know, just based on watching nature programs. So that was already part of my plan, you know, like PhD is a must. And then in high school, I started to think about, okay, what kind of research questions would interest me? And then in my 20s, I finally got my foot in the door to work on a wildcat project in Los Angeles. And in high school, I had developed this idea that studying species around urban landscapes would be novel and add to the field of ecology in a way that a lot of people aren't, because actually, relatively speaking, there hasn't been a lot of research about the way that animals adapt to urban landscapes. And so the opportunity to work with bobcats and mountain lions in Los Angeles, you know, a huge urban metropolis, was really exciting. And I volunteered on a project for 6 months. And so that's how I started my career with wildcats. And I learned with this position that studying the larger cats like mountain lions or pumas was just really difficult in terms of trying to generate data on a short time scale that would happen over the course of graduate studies, like me getting my PhD. And since bobcats were in the much more abundant, I decided, okay, well, I'm going to focus my research efforts on bobcats. And in doing so, I got really excited about working with small wild cats, and I understood how data deficient they are, and they really are overlooked by, you know, the general public and people and research institutions and funding institutions that are much more excited about funding research that happens on larger cat species. So that, I would say, is really how my career started to unfold. And then since then, I've just maintained this interest on continuing to work with small wild cats. And somehow I've lucked into being able to work for an organization called Panthera that focuses on conservation of all 40 wildcat species. And we have our own program that is dedicated to just small wildcats. And so through my work, my graduate work on bobcats, and then the Urban Caracal Project, which had a lot of, I developed the social media for the Urban Caracal Project quite well. And that got the attention of Panthera. And so Panthera actually approached me about working with them. And so it's just been extremely fortuitous, but also a lot of really hard work to get to where I am, to be able to live and continue to work on small cats as a career.
What people or meetings or books have most influenced your thinking about caracals?
Important resources have been those two books of Wild Cats of the World. One is written by Luke Hunter, and the other is written by Sundquist and Sundquist. In terms of inspiring me as a biologist, I've read the work of Alan Rabinowitz, who helped found Panthera. And he did work on larger wildcat species such as jaguars and tigers. and is just an inspiration in terms of how he was able to go into areas where people had done no research. And at the end of his work in that area, developed some large-scale conservation program that was novel to the area. For example, he set up the first jaguar preserve in the world.
Where do our knowledge gaps lie in terms of caracal conservation or management?
I think that it's really important to start branching out and studying caracals in other locations, in outside of Southern Africa, especially in Asian countries. Like, we really don't know what's happening with them in India. We know they're there, but their biology and how they're persisting in a landscape and facing many different kinds of challenges, we don't know. We've recently, in my organization, been working on a publication about caracals in Saudi Arabia. So that's another area where there's just essentially nothing known about the species and how they persist in such an arid environment. So I would say knowledge gaps are really understanding the ecology of the species outside of Southern Africa.
What might make a good project on caracals for wildlife biology students, undergraduates, and even postgraduates?
They are abundant in South Africa. And so I knew that I had a good chance of capturing enough caracals to be able to robustly understand their ecology in the system where I'm working. So for people who want to study caracals outside of Southern Africa, there's going to be massive challenges because for example, in Saudi Arabia, it's likely that they have extremely large home ranges. And when you start studying animals that are in low densities with extremely large home ranges, it's really difficult to study them, especially if you want to monitor their movements in spatial ecology. The other thing is that we don't know how they interact with other carnivore species. So no one has ever studied caracals in areas where there's other overlapping felid species, like servals, or even, you know, African wildcats, and certainly not in areas where there's apex carnivores like leopards and lions. And so how a full suite of carnivores, ecosystem with a full suite of carnivores, and how caracals, the ecology of caracals in that type of system is also relatively unknown. So I think there's a lot of space for a lot of questions that can be asked, but it's also extremely challenging to get on the ground and start addressing those questions. And so that's something that that is an obstacle for a lot of people, is how do I even get the funding to do the work, let alone once you're on the ground doing the work, how do I get the work done? Because they can be so difficult to find. So yeah, there's a lot of space for questions to be asked. It's just, I think more questions are to be answered, or how can we even begin to answer or address those questions on caracals outside of Southern Africa.
Laurel, is there anything that you'd like to add?
I mean, I guess I can add a little bit about what our work has been. So we focused on studying the ecology of caracals in Table Mountain National Park, which is surrounded by the city of Cape Town, is also a peninsula. So it's an extremely isolated environment. And we've been fortunate enough to study it, the population, from many different angles. But when we started our study, there was nothing known about the caracal population. And in fact, there was uncertainty as to whether there was even a population. And so it was quite a gamble for me to choose that area to study them, but I just had faith and confidence that they would be in that area. Since then, we've learned amazing things about them and their adaptability, such as our study area around Cape Town has a northern fragmented, much more urban exposed area. And then in the south, there's much less urban development. And it seems like caracals don't often move between the north and the southern part of the study area. Like caracals that we captured in the north stayed in the north, caracals that we captured in the south stayed in the south. And we observed that they exhibit some different behaviors in these two different areas. And we believe it's because of exposure to human activities in the northern section that they become somewhat habituated and adapt to human activities, even though they are an elusive species that generally does not want to, they don't want to interact with humans. And there are numerous threats that they experience by living in such close proximity to humans, including being exposed to poisons and diseases. And even recently, one of my favorite caracals was killed by a domestic dog and she was pregnant. And so it's just, you know, sort of there are some devastating things about these animals living in such close proximity to humans. And they're even poached, which surprises a lot of people in an urban environment that there's poaching of wildlife in that sort of area. And then a lot of them are hit by cars. So we found that despite all these threats, they're actually they're taking advantage of resources that are near humans. So there's disturbed landscape because of fire breaks, and in those fire breaks, small mammals such as lay rats are potentially more abundant, and they spend a lot of time hunting at the urban edge. Whereas in the south, where they're not exposed to humans as much, they actually avoid hunting near the urban edge. So we've just discovered some differences that are quite fascinating and show how adaptable the species is, including to humans, and that they're able to take advantage of extremely disturbed landscapes and even be abundant in a landscape where there's a lot of disturbance. So I think, based on what we've seen there, it gives hope that despite all the landscape change and climate change and persecution, that they're a species that somehow manages to persist. And I think that's really exciting and interesting and applies well outside our study area.
Laurel, can you state your job title, please, at the moment, and who you work for?
So I am a conservation scientist with Panthera, and I work specifically for their small cats program.
Laurel, it's been absolutely fascinating talking to you. Thank you very much for being on the Practical Animal Channel. Laurel Serious.
Thank you. It's been nice to chat with you as well.